As kids, you know.
You do.
I don't even know how to use memory sticks very well.
10 seconds.
So what are we supposed to do now?
No, nothing.
Nothing?
10 seconds to
air?
That
I can do. That I can do.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Tom's going to have to carry the load.
Yeah, I'll answer all
questions. He knows everything.
Okay.
Do you want some water?
Welcome. Welcome very, very much to Conversations. A pleasure to welcome to the program two gentlemen that are involved here in, what's the month? It's October of the year 2015. They're involved with an institution in the American cultural scene called the Living Theater.
That's right.
And there's been a recent demise or the passing of one of the founders of that, a giant intellectual of the theater, and that being Judith Malina. They had a recent event at the La Mama celebrating her life and so forth. And I'm very happy to have them on the television to talk about that and about her and about the Living Theater, and also to be notified by them that the Living Theater, which has suffered many eviction and so forth from places where they were established, it hasn't been the most solid, you know, situation, but the Living Theater lives in terms of a board that's getting together, and the Living Theater will be coming back. That's a message that'll be delivered as part of this program. And gentlemen, welcome very much to Conversation.
Thank you very much.
On my far left, John Martello, and John Martello is the executive director of the Living Theater, and he's the first person I met when I got to the theater, mm-hmm. and he informed me that the Living Theater lives, and my heart leapt up. And I want to thank you for that. And we're going to be talking about you got a board and all that sort of thing. And then a longtime member of the theater. I think he's, I couldn't believe how strong. We had probably 500 people at that thing. It was huge.
Yeah.
It was really. Mm-hmm. And when they mentioned your name, did you hear the applause that went up? Did you notice it? Maybe you're used to it. But there was a wow. I mean, from the rafters, they said Tom Walker. They said long-term member and archive director of the Living Theater. Yeah. But I made note of that because apparently you've made a big mark on the things over there, young man.
Well, I've been around longer than anybody else, really.
Well, there is something to be said for longevity. Yeah.
There are some veterans from the 60s who are in New York City, but they, you know, come around once in a while. But I'm active. We had this memorial for Judith Malina at La Mama, but it was not a memorial for the Living Theater, which continues, and it's been going for more than 65 years. I think we're almost up to 70 years now.
Yeah. 17 is 70.
Started, but we weren't talking about that, but it was in
1947.
Yeah, it's coming up to an anniversary. Yeah. Right.
Judith and Julian, who you see behind us, started the Living Theater in their apartment.
Is that right?
On West End Avenue, and they did plays in the room, so to speak.
Is that the same one they were in at 100?
No. They lived across the street when they were first married.
On Julian's, West End Avenue.
Yeah, Julian's father, who lived in 800 West End Avenue, paid the rent. And Judith and Julian lived there with their infant son, Garrick. And then Julian got a small inheritance of about $6,000, which today would be, what, I don't know, a lot more.
Yeah.
And he rented the Cherry Lane Theater for 2 years.
Ah, really?
In 1951, 52. And that's when they really began to have theater spaces in New York, and they began to create a theater of poetry with plays by Gertrude Stein and Kenneth Rexroth and Picasso and John Ashbery and W.H. Auden.
Real theater.
Real theater.
Yes, right.
Cherry Lane, in 1953, there was a play, I think it was The Age of Anxiety, maybe. The fire department came in and said the curtains were not, you know, flame-proof. So that closed that down.
Wow.
Then they had a theater in a loft on 100th Street in 54, 55, briefly. And then they really made their mark at a theater they created on 14th Street and 6th Avenue.
Yes, right. I remember there was a lot going on when that
They had it for 5 years.
Yes.
And that's where they did the landmark production of Jack Gelber's The Connection.
Oh, wow. Yeah, right.
About jazz and heroin addiction with jazz musicians in the play.
When did they do The Brig?
The Brig then was in 1963.
Okay, yeah.
That's the Marine prison play.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And they were doing that when the theater was very famously shut down in 63 with the accusation of back taxes, back rent, so forth. And the IRS came in and shut it down and padlocked it.
And who used to run interference for all those the people of the theater?
The lawyers, you mean?
Yeah, who ran interference for those? There's such a, I don't want to use the word loosely, but there's such a beautiful innocence of the artistic spirit. And certain, they ought to be protected from the likes of the sharks that run
lawyers,
the world. Who ran interference for
I don't
that,
know the actual
that cherished group of lovely people?
Lawyers. Mm. I mean, Judith
was... Lawyers and accountants and whatnot.
She was very close to Dorothy Day.
Dorothy Day was a giant.
To the Catholic worker people and Amon Hennessy. Mm-hmm. They had lawyers. But Judith would misbehave in the courtroom, as I said at the memorial.
Yeah.
When she was in trial one day with Dorothy Day, she was just acting out, acting up. She wasn't accepting the legitimacy of the court, and the judge said, have you ever seen the inside of a insane asylum? And Judith shot back, no, have you? And she was sentenced to an insane asylum for 10 days.
I'll be damned. Okay, what was the judge's... Well, actors do act.
Well,
you know, I
yes,
mean,
but,
you know, they would act up sometimes, one would think. You know.
And
can they act down?
In 64, when they had the trial about the closing of the 14th Street Theater, Judith and Julian were so unruly that although they were found innocent or put on probation for the charges, they got contempt of court. And Judith did a month, and Julian had to do 2 months.
2 months in a prison.
Danbury Correctional. Yeah. And Judith was out in Passaic.
And that's for that was for hijinks in the courthouse.
Yeah, for being obstreperous.
They seem to they're from an anarcho tradition. Kropotkin, right?
Yeah.
Or
mm-hmm.
Bakunin.
I behave in the courtroom when I'm there. I was
in
jail.
Well, I can see you're well behaved. You're like something from Yale, or something, you know, right? He's got the demeanor.
But
of
I was in jail with the Living Theater.
No, you've been in jail, right? Been
yeah,
some of the best
months.
Jails.
2 months. 2 months in
That's
Brazil.
That's a long time to be. Oh,
1971.
In Brazil. Oh, really?
That was one of our most serious jail moments because we were accused of being in the presence of marijuana. And by that time, the Living Theater was...
I'm shocked!
Very famous. Because, you see, when the theater got shut down in New York, they had a lot of engagements in Europe at that point. And they ended up being a vagabond troupe that went around Europe for 4 years. And they eventually came back in a famous American tour, 68, 69, with plays like Paradise Now, which had a lot of audience participation.
They were into that, always. Yeah.
Antigone, Frankenstein. And then they were back in Europe. And then they decided in 1970, famously, Judith and Julian, that they didn't want to do theater in the traditional theater venues. They wanted to take theater to the poorest of the poor, to the factory workers,
God bless them, God bless them.
And they went to Brazil where they did this. They did street theater. And Brazil was under a military dictatorship at the time.
That can be a clash.
And we used code words. Like
yes.
For revolution, we used the word decoration. For marijuana, we used the word leather.
Uh-huh, right.
And...
Got any leather, babe?
We did a play in a little town called Ouro Preto, which is a UNESCO World Heritage Site.
Yeah.
And they were having a winter festival. And we did a play at a children's school for Mother's Day about dreams of your mother.
Okay.
And it had a subtle anti-authoritarian element.
Subtle anti-authoritarian.
Well,
I'm sorry.
We used fables.
Yes,
you know,
okay.
But the priests, the local priests, knew that. The problem was they didn't know.
Yeah, right.
And
that
made them upset. They were worried.
That will.
And two priests signed the arrest orders, and they came storming in, the secret police, and it became a very celebrated bust. And there was a trial eventually, and there was a lot of international publicity.
Ooh,
great people, Genet, Arthur Miller, Jean-Paul Sartre, all kinds
of people. Just to name a few of the lesser lights.
Yeah.
Intellectual lights
all kinds
the
of
time.
People.
Yeah.
And some people signed things that they didn't even know they signed. Steve Israel, who was up here in New York, put together a big list with Jane Fonda and Mayor Lindsay and Bob Dylan and John Lennon, saying they all signed a thing protesting the Living Theater's incarceration.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It was not exactly accurate.
Oh, really? What was the in? Where was the
inaccuracy? They hadn't signed it. He sent it down to Brazil, and the Brazilian papers swallowed it hook, line, and sinker and didn't check it out. Whoa. And it hit the Brazilian press like a bombshell, and we were deported about 2 weeks later.
Really?
With the help of some high-priced lawyers.
Uh-huh.
We're very lucky.
Yeah.
We met some people in Brazil who were not so lucky, and we said to them, we can't really give you money. What can we do to help you? And they say, tell people what's going on.
Oh.
So that was the genesis of a play we did about torture.
What was that called?
On Brazil. Seven Meditations on Political Sadomasochism, which we did it here in New York at the Peace Church and all around in the early 70s. And then we were in Vermont and Pittsburgh. We took theater to the steel factories in Pittsburgh.
Yeah, but did you ever do anything sort of unusual as far as theater? You're talking all about regular theater. You have at the American Legion Hall or something like that.
No, all of our theater at that time in Pittsburgh
was... I'm making a joke.
I know.
I'm trying to be like what they call funny, okay?
Well, we did a play on a five-story high money tower.
Yeah, right.
And we did it in front of steel factories.
Yeah, right.
And we had steel workers coming out and watching the play, and we would have talks with steel workers about it all. It was not a very good way to make money.
Yeah.
Because it was out of doors, and it was too tall for most theaters.
I don't think that was your Trump suit making money.
No.
I don't think you had the right attitude toward money, young man. I would make a just.
We did go back to Europe and worked for 5 or 6 years in the late 70s, early 80s.
Is that in Genoa?
And we worked all over the place in and out of theaters. We went back into the theaters finally. We had to.
Yeah.
And we made our livelihood with plays in theaters. And you mentioned Genoa. That was much more recently in 2001.
You had a place there, a real nice place, I think.
In the late 90s, we got a residency. After Julian Beck died in 1985.
That's when he...
Tragically with cancer, too young, the age of 60. Mm-hmm. But Judith's second husband, Hanon Reznikov, and she kept the theater going. We did a lot of work, a little theater on the Lower East Side we had on 3rd Street in the early 90s. And then we did a lot of work in Italy, and we eventually were given a residency near Genoa for about 5 years.
Yeah, that's how you can speak Italian.
Yeah, it's one thing.
I saw a piece of clip and you're talking away in Italian as though it was, you know, like New York.
Julian said one thing to me once when we were in prison, we were waiting in the courtroom. He said, if nothing else in the living theater, you'll learn how to cook and you'll learn a foreign language.
It's like what's his name, the guy, Damon Runyon. I was standing over there and who should come along but Harry the Horse. Or something like, it's New York. It is New York and its world and everything. Now let's give you a chance. How about yourself? Talk a little bit about it. When did you pick a little bit of your background real quick, and then talk about getting involved with the living theater.
How far back?
let's say, when were you born, you know, or something like that?
The 3rd of February, 1952.
There you go. Okay.
Yeah, in the Bronx.
Yeah, Bronx. You're Bronx baby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And spent most of my childhood in the Bronx.
Mm-hmm.
All of my child in the box.
And good family of setting and everything?
Oh, sure. Italian-American family. Yes.
Good education. Intellectually relevant stuff going on at the dinner table and that?
A lot of yelling and screaming.
Oh, a lot of yelling and screaming.
Very Italian.
Very Italian-American.
Oh, Italian. I see. Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
He is Italian, and I just speak it.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah. But.
I went to school, high school, college, and. I studied history, political science as my majors, and discovered theater in my senior year.
Uh-huh. Was it living theater that had you to discover theater? Is that the way you were introduced to theater, or was it Shakespeare or something?
No, it was actually Robert Anderson, an American playwright, who I was sort of challenged to audition.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And I said to a friend, I said, yeah, you know, I was watching. I said, yeah, I always wanted to try that sometime.
Uh-huh. You know? Acting.
Yeah, acting. Yeah. They sort of tricked me into auditioning,
mm-hmm.
and I got the part.
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, said, fine, it's great. I'll do it. And I did it, and I got my first laugh, and I was hooked.
And did you get hooked?
Yeah.
Is that right to say? Right? Do you get hooked to being in theater?
Yeah.
It's good
that's
being.
What happens.
Is there something about being an actor that's very attractive or something? I bet, I was just thinking as you were recounting that, I'll bet there was a lot of moments of real, you know, danger and all that, but I bet there were a bunch of laughs.
Oh, yeah.
I bet you there must be humor that just hardly stops.
A lot of fun.
Yeah.
Judith was the most wonderful person to
hang
out with
and
to joke with, and she was so impassioned, and so she was always figuring out how to make the next move. And
she had a tremendous sense of humor.
Oh, yeah.
She was a great comic actress.
Yeah, right. And bursts of laughter and everything. It was just—it was infectious. And you got into it then and everything. And then when did you actually link up with the Living Theater? Yeah.
Well, I guess it must be about 6 years ago.
Relatively recent,
that,
right?
You know, I of course knew of the Living Theater and it seems to have seen some
it's
of the Living Theater over the years.
Yeah.
But I was running the Players, the theatrical club, and I got a call from Brad.
Brad's the new artistic director.
He's the new artistic director, Brad Burgess.
Yeah, brilliant fellow, yeah.
And he said, you know, we want to do a benefit for the Living Theater. We're thinking of having it at the Players. And I jumped at it.
I
said, come down.
Well, were you aware of them?
And Yeah, you were. I knew their work.
In theater are aware of the Living Theater.
Oh, yeah.
Are they?
Sure.
They stand like the Barrymores or something.
We did a beautiful performance of one of our plays, Renoir, and Edward Albee was right there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He's a great supporter of the Living Theater.
That's right.
I wonder maybe this would be, what do you guys think? We don't have to, but we got a clip. You have a real admirer, the Living Theater, y'all, and everything like that, a guy named Al Pacino.
Yes, indeed.
He's a star. He's a real star.
Yeah,
he was
big
in
star.
The Godfather and everything like that. And as I understand,
and he's opening a new play in New York now.
Is he doing it?
Always comes back to the theater. A new David Mamet play.
He's a real what they call
China doll. You should
see an artist. He is a real living, acting artist. You know, and that's a great part. The artistic
hung out at the Living Theater in the late 50s.
That he did that as a recruit.
Yeah.
He wasn't famous.
He was sweeping and cleaning the bathrooms.
Cleaning up the bathrooms and things like that.
He was rooming with Marty Sheen, who actually got some parts with the Living Theater.
Uh huh.
And then
did he do any performing with the Living Theater?
I'm not so sure.
I mean, Al Pacino.
I'm not so sure.
He was at that event.
Yeah.
He was at that event
the other night. Well, he credits the Living Theater with inspiring him.
Yeah. Yeah.
He certainly has been very generous to us, helped us financially.
Mm.
And
he adored Judith.
He really loved
What's
Judith.
What's not to adore?
Of course.
And
She's
he insisted
wonderful.
That she be his mother in Dog Day Afternoon.
I know, and we wanted to see that. You had that clip there. It was such acting. I couldn't believe how good that acting was that went on between her. It was just magnificent.
Yeah. It's a terrific scene.
But what we do have, we wanted to try and show that maybe on another occasion. We're going to try and get a program down the line here, presumably Brad and everything,
get
and
Brad
let people
back.
Know. And I'm so happy to have been greeted at this Requiem for Judith, to be told that Clinton Street had been closed down and all this, and you've been thrown out like the 14th Street.
Well, it wasn't quite the same. We just didn't have enough money to pay the exorbitant
rent. That's usually the problem, isn't it?
I mean, we were there for 6 years.
Yeah, on Clinton. Yeah.
The longest time we ever were in a theater space in New York. And it was very expensive. It was about $10,000 a month for the theater alone.
Yeah.
And we had a build-in of $30,000, and Judith's apartment upstairs was expensive, and the landlords could have given us a break, but they didn't.
They usually don't do that with the actors.
And one of them even made that film, Love and Politics, about Judith.
No, really? I don't know that one. Yeah, I got it.
It's on, I believe it's on Netflix.
Netflix,
okay, yeah.
By Azad Jafari.
It's on Amazon, too.
It's a film about Judith, did you?
Basically, in the Clinton Street period.
A full-length feature?
Yeah. While she was rehearsing.
Hour and 20 minutes, yeah.
20 minutes,
okay. Hour and 20 minutes.
No. Hour and 20, wow, I want to get that.
It's very sweet.
Yeah, I haven't seen that. Yeah.
Love and Politics. It's
worth seeing.
Okay, thanks for the clue, and people in the audience could look for that too. But what we do have now, since we're talking about it in this vein, we have a clip of Al Pacino.
Yeah.
That where he gives about 5 minutes, right? And he talks about, he puts the Living Theater in a proper perspective, it seems to me, by saying something along the order, if I remember, we're going to play it. They're going to play it in the booth, because set it up, they'll play it. The Living Theater is the best representation of the art and the loveliness and the beauty of theater ever in the history of the world. or something like that, yeah, which is a hell of an accolade
he's
from
pretty
somebody.
Enthusiastic.
There was yeah. a no. He makes a very definitive statement, which I don't want to spoil for
your audience.
I think
it might
audience.
Be good to play it now, don't why, you?
Why,
why don't we do it? So
why don't
you play it?
Very wise.
We got that clip. If you could bring up that
just
thing.
There is no fourth wall.
Okay,
Nobody
here we go.
Says there's a fourth wall. You know, it's just it really is a fourth wall in movies. You know, it's the camera, but in the theater, how can you? We're all here together. If you go to the New Globe, the way they've done it.
Yeah.
I mean, you see, I mean, this is, it's like being at a ball game there. I mean, people are getting up in the middle of it. This is how it was born. The theater is in the room. The Living Theater taught me that. It's in the room. When I saw Paradise Now up there in the Brooklyn Academy, and I went in there and they came up to you, you're sitting in the theater and they came up to you and they said, I can't smoke pot. You know, and then you knew they were going to take their clothes off next, and you thought maybe they're going to take your clothes off. And then pretty soon you're just sitting there, and you're like, well, I don't know if I like this very much. And then you hear people screaming up in the balcony, and then a fight breaks out, and you start getting scared, and things start to happen, and you say, what's going to happen next? I mean, I think I'm in trouble. I mean, what did I do? I just came to the theater. I wanted to see a play, right? And now this is going on, and this is the Living Theater. Oh, they're doing it again, you know. So two of the people I was with left. They said, this is nonsense. People getting up saying, you're children, you're just children, and they're leaving. Oh, get out of here. Look at, and they say, I paid money for this. And the Living Theater shouts back at them, there's no such thing as money. There's no such thing as money. You know, oh, yeah, right. So they go off. So there we are, and I'm sitting there with my girlfriend at the time, and she, for some reason, wants to stay. I don't know. I want to stay, but I'm scared. So I said to her, you know, I don't know what's going on, where this is going, but I'm going to go outside and have a smoke, and I'll be back in a minute. So I go outside in Brooklyn. I'm standing outside. You know, I'm pacing around, and the thing is going on in there. I don't know what's happening, you know. So I have my cigarette. Dare I go back in, you know. Okay, so I go back in, and what do I see? I guessed it was the juxtaposition from being outside now in. I walk into something that was so alive. It was like walking into somebody's anatomy with a heart's breathing, pulsating, and everything about life is in this room. The room had changed.
It's funny.
From the moment I had gone out to when I came back, and it was now this live, living theater, living theater.
The people in the audience were now on the stage.
People were up, screaming, pontificating, naked people. But the atmosphere had changed. And there was a collective going on. And now the audience became the theater. They were the event. They were the play. It was orchestrated, the whole thing. And then one side of the theater was Judith Malina. Mm-hmm. And on the other side was Julian Beck. Mm-hmm. And they were corralling this thing. They were corralling this event. They were controlling it on either side. They were in control of it. They were orchestrating it. And it was literally the most exciting, vibrant, alive thing that I can only describe it as being, as changing my life. Paradise Now. Now, what was that? That has definitely had an effect on me. I think it had something to do with Looking for Richard. Because I never, and I have been a great fan of Living Theaters. I mean, I loved them and worked with them in the Brig and Connection and all the things they did in the early 60s, which were, you know, and then after they were subsequently thrown out of this country. But the point is, what they were after, what they had generated, the excitement, a certain kind of theater, which is one of the things we say about the theater, because when you come in the movies too, you go in and you don't know what's gonna happen. You don't know how your life is gonna change.
What was unsatisfied in you by all the other work that drove you to produce, in some cases,
well,
to direct?
Well, I think, like I said before, my experiences when I was younger in the 60s and seeing the Living Theater produce some of the greatest theater ever. And I was there. I used to clean toilets there with Marty Sheen, and we both were backstage, put the sets on for the Connection and all this great theater. And then went on to Marty Sheen actually went and got into one of the plays there at the Living Theater, and then went on to see them do Paradise Now and Frankenstein and all the great things they did in the late 60s. There was nothing like that. It's part of what's informed my life, really. This part of my life, what I call, for want of a better word, I don't know why I'm using this word, but it seems to suit
avant-garde.
Yeah. Which means what? It just means something that I learned when I was a kid in the village growing up, that there was some sort of a connection to things at that time for me that I somehow still am linked up to. Yeah. And that is why I made these pictures, because they all remind me in some way of that period of my life.
Beautiful, beautiful. Was that dude's name Harold? Did he say Harold?
No.
That guy that was talking, wasn't Harold?
Richard Brown.
Oh, it was Richard. I thought I heard Harold. I've heard it wrong. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful, though?
It's
that guy,
sweet.
He's so gorgeous, you know?
Judith and Julian inspired him and inspired generations of, people. So many people. You keep coming across people. We did the last play that Judith wrote, No Place to Hide, in Washington Square Park last summer. And we actually just rehearsing it. And one woman came up to me and said, I saw the Living Theater in Europe in 1969, and it changed my life.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, theater goes way back in terms of the art. Where does theater sit in terms of the arts overall? I mean, it goes as a history, I suppose. I had a friend.
You know, television's changing.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Film is changing.
Yeah.
We don't even know in 20 years whether or not people are going to go to the movie theaters anymore.
And everybody's going around.
Everybody's going around. They're watching Lawrence of Arabia on their cell phones, you know, that sort of thing.
How can you do that?
They do pictures.
But the theater's not going to change.
Really?
You're always going to have people gathering to hear a story told.
Storytelling.
That's
oral tradition, maybe?
It's not a church. It's not a political meeting. It's not a... it's theater. And certainly with Living Theater, we make ritual.
That's Queen of the Arts, would it be fair to say?
Too strong. Music is great. Yeah, poetry is great. Mm. Painting is great.
They're all great.
It's all great.
But in terms of the performing arts, other than ballet or opera, which is specific things, I think in terms of the three mediums of stage, television, and a film, I think theater is going to be truest to itself and still exist in its purest form as it has for 2,000 years.
I had a friend I mentioned.
2,500 years.
Yeah. 25?
2,500
years. So where do we date it back to, the first theatrical thing?
Well,
that's
let's go back to
Aeschylus,
right?
Well,
the Greeks.
Aeschylus,
the
yeah.
The Greeks, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Thespis.
500
one
BC.
Problem I think theater has, John, is the money-making aspect, which tends to sometimes make it more conservative than the other arts.
Right, except that you're still going to have companies like... That's why I think much of the future of this art form is off-Broadway. And
off-Broadway, not Broadway.
Because
Broadway is all money.
I agree that on Broadway, which I respect and I have regard for, because they've accomplished a great deal.
Yeah.
But it has become so commercialized that, but you can still have a company like the Living Theater that'll perform in Washington Square Park or perform on the highway, the skyway there, whatever it is.
The High Line.
The High Line, and gather a crowd and tell the story and have people moved and have people excited and have people engage themselves in it.
Mm-hmm.
We even went to the Burning Man Festival
there
in the desert of Nevada last summer.
You did?
Last year.
You did that first time you've gone?
Oh, yeah.
You go Rainbow Collector?
No, that's different. The Rainbow Gathering is a different thing than the Burning Man Festival.
It is. Burning Man has a lot to do with technology and stuff,
and new technology. Everything has to be brought in, everything is taken out. It's in a forbidding desert with 100 degree heat.
Nevada somewhere.
And northeast of Reno, Nevada.
Mm-hmm.
And we did the play, No Place to Hide. We constructed
there at last year, you mean?
Yeah.
Oh, I see. That was the first time you all had gone there?
We constructed a little
how many of you got
black box with metal pipes and canvas. There were about 20 of us.
Wow, that's a lot.
Judith didn't go. She was alive still.
Yeah.
But she didn't go, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And it was very wonderful. And there we were in the midst of that crazy
Did you find camaraderie with the other folks there?
Lovely.
It's art. It's part of an art. Yeah.
We did the show every night, and we did pop-up events in conjunction with a Bhutto dance group. And we were very much part of the atmosphere there.
What about the arts? What's the role of the arts? Where do the arts fit in? We got all kinds of things. The arts, they call art of this, art of that, art of war making, which is sort of a crazy thing. Art, well, the art of the deal. I think, isn't there a book by Mr. Bush or Mr. Trump saying the art of the deal?
Well, politics is certainly show business.
You think? You know, yeah, it is, isn't
Bernie
it?
Sanders or Hillary Obama is one of the greatest communicators who's been around.
We're
in politics all the time. Our theater is always political. Sometimes we're involved directly with political groups, but whenever you come see a living theater play, it's participatory. Judith,
always
in her later years, liked to take away the chairs and make everyone dance. She was very angry in the 60s in many ways, you know, in front of judges, but also on stage. Famously angry in the play Antigone. But also Paradise Now had a lot of hectoring of the audience and so forth. And of course, if you do that, the audience argues back.
Hectors back,
In her more recent years, Judith was very into paradise and utopia and love and softness and trying to persuade the audience with beauty.
Really? You've noted that.
And right? Not aggressive
and
hectoring.
And you've been, as they say, tight.
Yeah, I was
Judith
in all of them.
And Hanon.
And, you know,
Hanon? Julian.
Yes, worked with him for 12
years.
So
12 years.
Yeah.
So you're a historian of the living theater. You know of what you talk. And it had a different modulation.
But we went softly. After Paradise
softly
Now, felt we had to approach the audience softly. Like, if you don't want to come and participate, that's all right. You can stay in your chair and watch, and somebody else can do it. And I also want to say, a lot of us work with other groups.
Yeah,
we're not some little cult where we won't. I've worked with local New York groups. One of them's called The Assembly. Another one's called The Team. Uh-huh. Brad is working at CUNY Grad Center as we speak.
Really, a lot going on.
He's
at CUNY,
helping to produce the Prelude Festival they're doing right now with Frank Henschker.
Uh-huh.
I worked with a group called the Dara Luce Company with Reza Abdo, one of the greatest actors, directors rather, I've ever known in the 90s. So we're not, you know, just living theater, but we focus on living theater, and we have a good dedicated group right now that's working very hard. And Judith left us something in the drawer.
What was that?
It's a play.
Oh, right. Really?
Which we will work on this winter.
Wonderful to know.
I don't want to give away the title or anything right now.
Oh, come on.
Because it's very, well, Venus and Mars.
Okay.
But it's
thanks.
Very much in flux right now. We'll see. I mean, we'll probably do No Place to Hide again because it's a good, easy play to do, no set. It's great when you have a play with no sets.
It makes it easy,
economic.
I guess, right? Yeah, yeah. Right.
We did some plays with these enormous sets, the Money Tower, Prometheus. And we couldn't do them too many times because too expensive.
Yeah, right. That's a consideration. Yeah.
Julian, but also Julian was a great artist.
He was
a great painter. Yeah, right.
I mean, I didn't see many of those productions, but if you look at photographs of those productions, the concept, the physical concept of these productions
are
astonishing.
Y'all are
astonishing.
Artists. No, the art, is it translated? I had a friend, I mentioned to you, Ornette Coleman. He lived in our building.
He was friends of Judith and Julian.
Too. Yeah, what about? And everything. And it's an aside, but we had talks. We both came. And then I want to get around to philosophy. They were anarcho. There's an anarcho bent to what they had. Bakunin, Kropotkin, Russia, one thing's in that. And that's got a rich that anarchistic tradition.
The IWW.
IWW today.
And Murray Bookchin.
Murray Bookchin, particularly, I'd like to mention, because Murray Bookchin is somebody I'm really interested in, because Murray Bookchin was a fellow of the Living Theater, and he was into his whole life in terms of looking at the human condition in terms that would be sort of like political, if that means sort of to the reality of the world rather than fantasy,
well,
where you could conjure.
Well, he tried to be realistic about, could anarchism really work? He had the famous book, Post-Scarcity Anarchism. A lot of people think anarchism means black block and violence chaos.
Yeah, I know.
And that's not it at all for us.
No, yeah. Let's spell it out. It's really
important. Some of these militant anarchists, when we would talk pacifism, would get very upset.
Mm-hmm.
But I think anarchism is the respect of the individual, and you can't do that and be violent, I believe.
If you really do, if you live by it.
Murray believed that, too.
Yeah.
And the Living Theater was always trying, in its plays, to, along with the art and the beauty, try to promote the beautiful nonviolent anarchist revolution.
Okay, new violent,
nonviolent anarchist revolution.
Okay, that's beautiful. Okay,
and
that's
some people.
Sometimes anarchism gets linked with something that isn't necessarily nonviolent and beautiful.
Well, some people would say to Julian, you know, I understand the anarchism, I understand the pacifism. The
nonviolent. Julian, you're talking now?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But what is this beauty thing?
Yeah,
what is this
beauty thing?
And Julian said, well, if it's not beautiful, I'm not interested in it.
Uh-huh.
Julian had a wonderful, ethereal way of
putting
it all together. He could make anything. He was a master lighting designer.
Was he really? I didn't know.
He was a pretty good administrator.
Administrator?
Well, he kept the bill collectors at the door.
Well, that's a pretty good skill set, I guess. That's pretty good. But,
I always thought, working with Julian, that he was the one all organized and Judith was kind of the nervous one. But eventually I realized that Julian, in a sense, was more sort of self-sacrificial. He really took care of everybody. Didn't like doctors very much, so I wish he had gone to the doctor a little more and had some of those, you know, colonoscopies and things like that.
Yeah.
Might have lived longer. Judith, on the other hand, was...
60s too young, yeah.
Judith was a real survivor. Mm. You know, her parents escaped the Holocaust.
Well, she was 88 or something. Just recent.
One half her family was wiped out.
Yeah.
She decided at an early age she was never going to cook because she saw that her mother was enslaved to cooking. And she decided, I'm never going to cook. And she didn't. And luckily, she met her prince, Julian, who could cook very well.
He could cook. Well, that's a great, thing made in heaven.
Her mother taught Julian how to cook.
Wow. That's really something. They should get that on film.
Julian said, I want to get married at one point. And Judith said, well, we can't get married. I can't cook. And he said, that's all right. I'll cook.
That's sweet. You know? That's funny.
They had a very unusual marriage.
They had
physical relationship.
Yeah.
They had one son.
Mm-hmm.
But eventually it was an open relationship because Julian was very much a bisexual and had been treated by a psychiatrist for being gay. This was out in the open with his parents.
Mm-hmm.
And the psychiatrist suggested, why don't you choose a different name, something more masculine than Julian, you know, like Dick or Tom. Julian said to Judith, well, if I ever become gay again, I'll kill myself. And she said, no, it's all right. You can be whatever you want, you know. And so he had his assignations and she had hers. And sometimes they'd have a trio.
Yeah.
Eventually, she would settle down to rather long monogamous relationships in the 60s.
Mm.
One with Carl Einhorn for many, many years, who's the father of her daughter,
Isha. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then with Hanon, she lived with him almost 30 years.
Well, it was after,
And Julian had a long-term companion, Ilian Troia, also.
Mm-hmm.
And he came out much more as a gay man in his 50s, in a way, for the press. Because in the 50s, New York thought Judith and Julian were a heterosexual item. And, of course, everyone at the San Remo and the Cedar Bar knew that they weren't. And I think some people like John Cage and...
Those are hangout places.
Cunningham and John O'Hara.
Yeah, right.
Frank O'Hara and John Ashbery. Allen Ginsberg. Mm. They were gay men being gay men, and they realized that Judith and Julian were kind of having it both ways. But
I wonder if we could get back. They were anarcho, and they're not Marxists.
No.
They're not left wing in that sense.
Well, anarcho-syndicalists. They were always with left-wing people.
They hated authoritarianism, I would say. I would venture to say. I mean,
they knew that the Marxists...
I'm very bad that way. I don't like authoritarianism.
Stalin had the Marxists wipe out the anarchists in Spain. It was very nasty.
Right.
And, you know, Emma Goldman and Alexander Berkman left Leninist Russia quite deluded.
Mm.
So that was always a problem.
I was very anti-authoritarian. I was drafted into the army. You had to be drafted. I was at that age between Korea and North.
Yeah.
And I was not. I was like Costello, I think.
Did you go in?
Yeah, I had to. I was drafted, but I didn't like it. It's very. I used to try and explain as a buck private to the sergeants that we could do things more democratically.
Oh, they don't like to.
They don't want to hear that. The authoritarian personality is of a different nature. And it seems to me the institutions are all essentially authoritarian, and the manna is money.
The workplace.
It seems to me there's nothing more significant in terms of understanding the human condition or the human structure, everything. It's money. I mean, there's other things, love, feeling, really important, you know, these kind of things.
Very few people.
But money seems to trump everything else to an inordinate degree.
There are very few
people. Does it seem that way to you?
Yeah, there are very few people who have work where they control themselves or feel that they're somewhat in control.
Yeah.
In an architectural firm, I don't know. I mean, artists are those people, usually, mm-hmm. who are doing it for themselves. But it's a tiny minority who get to be people who can support themselves from their art.
Okay, now back again to Murray Bookchin, God bless him. He passed some time ago and everything, but he was into, and I heard it came trippingly off your tongue, post-scarcity anarchism, you call it. Post-scarcity. Ornette and I used to talk a great deal, and I'm just wondering how it was in the coterie of people you were connected with in living theater, from the beginning and all like that, in terms of that idea. Or the personage of a couple of people that come to my mind, James Joyce, or Marshall McLuhan, mm-hmm. or Buckminster Fuller. Mm-hmm. Were any of those people part of the thinking?
Well, Joyce inspired Judith and Julian because their first theater was a poet's theater.
Okay.
They never did a play by Joyce, but you know he was part of it.
Yeah.
All with Stein and Ashbery and the poets who grew out of World War II were mm-hmm. all influenced by Joyce. And Fuller and McLuhan had these visionary ways of how people could be free. I mean, a lot of the anarchists thought that the assembly line was going to free the worker, and instead it enslaved the worker.
Right.
It's terrible that we could feed all the people, that we could have a world that wouldn't have to be slowly descending into this fossil fuel climate change disaster, which is often caused by the wars, which are terrible ecological
things. Aren't they awful?
Things.
Aren't they awful?
All these migrants.
And they just go on and they kill 500,000 people with no, you know, and then they get all worked over when a couple of people, you know, it's horrible.
All of
war.
Syria is emptying
awful.
Out.
Yeah, I know.
And they're
it's
all
awful.
Going to France or the Europe that
or
I knew.
Germany.
Is being transformed. Mm. And I keep thinking, you know, somebody's going to make a play or a movie about a boat of tourists. You know, I apologize that I'm a Yale graduate almost. I sort of was an anti-Yale Yaley at that time. But because because I'm an alumnus, I get all these brochures about these trips that people spend $7,000 or $8,000 going around the Mediterranean or going to Cuzco or going to Singapore.
Yeah.
And I can just see one of these yachts off Sicily and they crash into a boat filled with 40 migrants sinking. And they have to make a decision. Are they going to take all these people up on the boat? And some people will say yes, you know, bleeding heart liberals.
Mm.
And some of the wealthy
let
will say,
die.
Please.
Let them die.
It could be a great movie. Mm.
Yeah,
you know,
right. It would
talking
be.
About
the
disaster that we're in right now.
But what I'm trying to get around to is in terms of using the term, it comes trippingly off the tongue, post-scarcity.
Yeah.
Now, if you go, because if it's money and everything, that seems to be, and economics, okay? And Bookchin. Bookchin had this idea. He was into it, full tilt boogie, as they would say, into post-scarcity. Mm-hmm. And who was in the, of all the work that was done by Fuller, Buckminster Fuller, the major premise of his whole life's work was a projection of a situation where he took, and what does it mean in the human condition, what we got, 200,000 years we've been here, something like that, 10,000 generations. We've been here as a species and everything. All the resources were here when we came out of the cave. Yes. All the oil was here. Everything was here. All the land, everything was here. We had a rendezvous with relating technologically to the resource base that was part of this planet and so forth. It was all here. And we had that. And then what does it mean to be a have? Seriously, I mean, it's not just to be laughed off or something. What does it mean to be? And he did in World Game. He was down at Carbondale, and he did this thing. And they've got it up on the site now. They finally put it up. The design decade 65-75, and at the Carbondale. It's a major study of all the trends, all the resources. Uh-huh. What are the resources? How do you get the, what are the resources?
What website is that?
It's at BFI.
Buckminster Fuller website?
They just put it up. I got to get in touch with John McConville. He's put that up, and Emily Thompson. But they've got it up, and it's all the research where they're taking an understand. This would be something that you could put, but to get at the idea of haveness, what does it mean to be a Homo sapien have? In modern terms,
the capitalist system of privilege.
But isn't it always been? Well, I mean, we had feudalism, we had Hammurabi.
Yeah, there's always been the ruling class.
Yeah, and I don't think those people who drug those stones across the desert to build a thing for the pharaoh were particularly happy at doing that.
No.
I don't think it would be like slavery after the Neolithic and everything. So it's always been a few people living in the castle
and
on the hill.
The dream of Israel, which was a beautiful dream. Mm. It's now become this horrible thing where we have the biggest ghetto in the world, otherwise known as Gaza. When we did the Money Tower in the 70s, we were very influenced by Bookchin.
Yeah, and were you really?
We showed this Money Tower, which is an old postcard from the Wobblies of the social class.
Wobblies,
You know, the lowest of
workers
the low, the
of
working
the world,
class, the bourgeois, the technocrats, and the
right.
elite.
I know the one you mean.
And we worked it out with actors and biomechanics and so forth. And we showed how the system worked. And eventually there was a strike. And a worker goes up the elevator, a little elevator in the Money Tower, to present the demands to the ruling class. And they said no. And they send the police after the workers, and we say, brother, don't shoot, which was an old thing from the Haymarket days in the 19th century.
Right.
We had a utopian ideal ending where we tried to show how society could work. We used apples, passing them around, and we had a lot of lovely utopian Buckminster Fuller-like phrases.
You can do worse than Fuller.
And we went out into the audience and with microphones and asked people what they thought. It was a very utopian, hopeful
vision. One of the books, Fuller wrote, Utopia or Oblivion, he wrote one. They wrote a number of books.
Yeah.
And he had a theme, and the theme that underscored his work.
Was it called Utopia or Oblivion?
Yeah, there's a book, Utopia
really?
Or Oblivion.
That's interesting.
And other books he's written and everything. And then he had all this. But they did all this work in trying to take a measurement of what does it mean, the world. So you got all the human beings, you got population trends, you got resources, you got growth, and then they took, and what they measured in this thing was haveness. What does it mean to be a Homo sapien have? How do you define it? What does it mean? Is there any point in doing it?
Well,
maybe it's not worthwhile even bothering about because everybody knows you can never
be. I think ideally to have means you have food, clothing, shelter, and happiness. And you don't need all the riches of Trump. And
that's making an assumption about how you define it. I mean, it would be, Mr. Marx used to say, from each according to his ability to each according to his need.
Yes.
But how about reasonable wants? Okay, not just needs, but wants.
Healthcare.
And what about the idea? And he had the thing where he took a measure of the percentage of the world population that can be seen to be a have in historical terms, in terms of our capability. Let's just say one of the things that's good about being a have in the world that's coming and so forth is you can get on an airplane in New York and go 3 hours to Los Angeles. You couldn't do that in 1900.
No.
Historically, we were limited in terms of what we were able to do. Now we got all this technology coming. Nanotechnologies is coming, and the design and so forth. But he had a measurement of that. And he had they had a measurement they came down to, and it was that, well, what percentage of the world population, and grunts or giants, and was through time? And they put up a, they did, it's a study that could be done at any think tank or anything. But he did it, and they said that we had, what percentage, by their reckoning and everything, was it, and it went like this, and it was, and it crossed, it finally, that's the world projected in the future, and he said that we got, it was less than 1% actually just coming out of the 19th century in terms of the collective capability of our, it's going exponential, the capability in our time. It's going, and he said that it was
debatable going, whether or not it's getting better. I mean, we have 20,000 atom bombs or something on the planet.
Well, that's one of the aspects.
Terrible.
Dangerous. I had a program with Ramsey Clark the other day. He was a magnificent guy, Ramsey Clark, magnificent. Mm-hmm. And he says he thinks the Trident fleet has the capability, because on one side is the destructive capability that's characteristic of our extended consciousness capability to lay us on it with the planet of the world we're born into. And they finally reached a point where realpolitik, whoever's got the biggest club, could establish political legitimacy by hitting the other on the head.
Yeah.
And setting it up with soldiers and things.
Are we supposed to be relieved that Russia is whacking ISIS now and propping up Assad? Will that end this insanity for a while?
Yeah, but that's one issue out of the news. Okay, that's good, and that's what's going on. But what he's looking at is the trend through time that ought to be given credence. And Mr. Bookchin was dealing with it, it seemed to me. And nobody seems to be able to sue it, because it's assumed, like economics is called the science of the allocation of scarce resources. It's assumed that there always has to be scarcity as an ontologic reality, that we can never get ahead of that curve.
This will no doubt be our subject in Venus and Mars.
Well, I don't know.
Because Mars is the problem and Venus is the solution.
Well, that's just Venus and Mars and love and all that and everything. But no, but this is materialistically looking at the material.
It comes down to that.
And he gets down and he said that he did it from, they projected out. We crossed the 50%, and the weapons became species lethal at its level of capability, not the reality. You don't confuse the two. It's a capability you're dealing with, and that's different. That's latent or something. The weapons became species lethal about the year 1970. They hadn't been. There would have been a few scraggling survivors if they'd let it full-tail boogie like 1905 or something, you know, they could do, where people are just fighting over who's got the better story or something. Yeah. They crossed the 50% mark in terms of the percentage of the world population that could be seen to be a have by standards that have to be agreed upon about the resources.
So you think things are getting better?
Yes, and that there's a chance that this new book by Kurzweil and DeMontes.
It's good to be hopeful.
It's called Abundance.
Yeah.
And that, is it possible that we're coming and be born into the 10,000th generation when we actually cross the line from where there has been an ontologic reality of scarcity? For one to win, another has to lose. That was the reality. It's built into all our institutions, our thinking, everything. There never can be enough for all. And the ecology.
Well, I'm
and
all
it's,
for
it's dreamy impossibility.
A better socialistic distribution of everything.
Well, that's a
certainly
different proposition. That's
well,
a different,
but that's more and more and more people being on the have
no
side.
But you see, the thing is, it's you've crossed that. We've already crossed that line in terms of capability, not the reality.
But there's a lot of people who don't have.
Absolutely. But we've always had a vast majority of peasants and serfs, where the few people are up in the castles eating off gold plates.
But
always
we shouldn't
been
accept
like
that as a status
no,
quo.
No, but it has been the status quo in all
agree.
Of our institutions.
Of course,
all of our
course.
Institutions, our thinking, and everything in our assumptions. And our assumption is there never can be enough for all. But that may not
be. I think there could be.
No. There hasn't been.
No, there hasn't been. But.
And there has now, we've come to a point where it could be possibly to advance if you have a careful consideration of, rather than dismissing it as ipso facto absurd, that there can be enough for all.
Agreed.
So that everybody can have what they need in order to realize their full potential, rather than just having a few. yeah. that can do that. Do you understand?
That's
that
it.
That qualitative transformation is occurring in the evolution of consciousness in universe at our time,
that
our
generation. That was Murray's point.
That was Murray, and it was Buckminster Fuller.
Also, yeah.
And it's never mentioned.
Well, not
All
enough.
They do is talk about if we get a tax cut, then maybe we can get to there. Or if the Republicans win, or if the Democrats, or if this happens or that happens.
You think
the
that
historical
in,
pattern,
in the present atmosphere with Cornel West and Naomi Klein and Stiglitz and all these people, not enough of them are talking about this?
Nobody's
kind of
talking about it.
Nobody?
Nope. You don't see. It should be if...
Hakim Bey.
No. No, I'm just saying it should be up on the thing on the wall of every think tank, including the office of the President of the United States.
Well, what
there
are we going to do about it?
Enough.
We're going to make a play about it.
Well,
that's what we
ought to
do. That's what Judith would do.
Well,
know.
in the legacy of Julian and particularly Judith and everything that we started off talking about, and particularly, if I may, Murray Bookchin.
Yes.
He was overlooked. What he was saying, that he was projecting what Fuller, and Fuller is a serious intellectual that ought to be paid attention to by the intellectual community that could inform the political class.
Judith was pretty relentless about this.
Uh-huh.
I mean, in play after play after play, you know, John, History of the World, which we did
That's right.
4 years ago, then here we are. And here we are, there was like a history lesson of what happened in the Ukraine with Nestor Makhno, what happened, you know, an anarchist who got snuffed out by the Bolsheviks. Of course, it wasn't pacifist, but, and then the Paris Commune scene, which of course wasn't pacifist, but there were efforts to organize in a, you know, and then the Spanish Civil War.
Yeah, right.
And she had these three things happening, and then she went on in another way with song and dance, and she had this new form that she created in the last few years called the free flow.
Okay, I have to give you a 2 minute warning. We only have 2 minutes,
right.
So use haiku.
Well, the free flow is the actors have rehearsed,
yes.
And the audience hasn't, but they bring their unrehearsed truth,
uh-huh.
And we improvised in a beautiful kind of dance,
mm-hmm.
And it wasn't, she said, oh, don't do dance, don't wave your arms, do things that are meaningful, and we would have song, and it would be utopian, and it would be organizing, because there would be discussions afterwards about exactly what we're talking about.
Well, I think we ought to all be talking about it, to tell you the truth, and Murray Bookchin could be a leader of that, and that's the living theater. And they could
well,
be
you've
a
inspired me tonight.
Oh, you've inspired me, and you certainly have inspired me.
Well,
you've inspired me with your word that the living theater is alive and kicking and well, and you got
absolutely.
A board of directors that are putting it together in serious, practical terms. It lives, it lives, it lives.
Well,
thank goodness. Yeah. And so welcome. Thank you for viewing. It's your pleasure to have the perception that Tom Walker, a long-term member and archive director of the Living Theater, and John Martello, executive director of Living Theater, a major institution that ought to be supported by every thinking person. In fact, ought to be supported by every person, even if they think or not, on this planet. Thank you for viewing. We'll be coming
thank
back.
Thank you for having us.
We're going to be
thank
coming
you.
Back again
thank you,
tomorrow.
Harold.
And thank you, Murray Bookchin. Thank you, Judith. Thank you, Julian. And thank you to you and all in the Living Theater. Give my best to one and all, please.
Oh, we'll do.
Thank you for viewing.
Thanks.
We're coming back again to tomorrow, so tune in tomorrow. There'll be a program with Julian and Hanon that we're going to air tomorrow after this program.
Oh, wonderful.
Okay,
really?
So we're coming back tomorrow. Thank you.
That's wonderful.
I didn't mean to dominate the conversation.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. He's